Hello, friends. Welcome to Kurt Berglund's Baseball World. You know, I get lots of emails all the time from folks telling me about their replays, their projects that they're doing, and I've gotten one big question of late from people, and that is, Kurt, how do you keep the fire going to keep your replay active and keep working on it? 162 games is a long way to go. Whether you're doing as-played lineups because you don't want heads to explode all over this great land of ours, or if you are making your own lineups, making even maybe your own schedule, a long tournament, a full-season replay, maybe it's a career replay you're doing, all sorts of stuff. How do you keep the interest level going? How do you stay motivated? So I want to talk about that in today's video and show you some ways that I do it. I'd be interested to hear your ways and your suggestions in the questions and comments underneath the video as well. Maybe we can add sort of our own tips and tricks to keep motivated, keep the project going. Before I get into that, don't forget to check out channel membership on my channel. I've got a link to get all the information about becoming a channel member. You get discounts on the secondary store, $10 off every set, $2 off of every individual team. You get a free gift from me every month. You get an archive of exclusive members-only videos and lots more. So I encourage you to check that out. It's in the description for this video. All right. So how do I keep interested? And I'm going to show you some ways that are not going to break your budget at all, but ways that I've kept interested with some projects that I am undertaking currently. The first one, and I know Baseball Reference is our statistical guide in the 21st century to finding out information about the players we are doing replays on. And it's a wonderful resource, no question about it. So is Seam Heads. If you are interested in the Negro Leagues, it's fantastic. Contains stuff Baseball Reference has not contained. But a good copy of Who's Who in Baseball can go a long way to giving you the same information. It keeps you offline. If you get sick of being online like I do, Who's Who in Baseball is a wonderful resource. This is the 1951 Who's Who in Baseball. Doesn't have pictures. Some of them have like thumbnail shots of the players, face pictures of the players. If you haven't seen one, all the stats are in there, not the sabermetric stuff, of course, and nobody's calculating war in 1951, thank God. But you get the basic stats, and it's a little handy thing to have handy when you're doing your replay. I keep mine nearby. Second, the Sporting News, every year, produced guidebooks to the particular season that just ended. So this is the 1951 edition of the official baseball guide. And so it covers the year before, it covers the 1950 season. Has stats in here, but there's also something else that is like a theme of this video, and that is the written narrative of the season. You get stuff in here that stats do not cover. The impressions of writers from Sports Illustrated of the season, even though they aren't given a byline, you're getting contemporary viewpoints and descriptions of the season that just finished and the playoffs and World Series, if there were playoffs, and certainly the World Series as well, along with all the stats and a lot of pictures too. You can pick these up on the cheap because nobody wants them anymore. Kind of like Who's Who in Baseball, you can get them awfully cheap because only collectors are looking for them and there's not that many collectors. And especially if you don't care as much about condition of these books, You can get them for $5 or less if you know where you're looking. Resale, online resale booksellers are looking to give them away almost, and so they're great. And they're not very large. They fit right on your table next to what you're doing. Great stuff. The next thing is the most expensive thing that I'm going to show you, and that is if your team had a book written about it, or if there was a ballpark involved. If Sabre has written ballpark books as well, maybe you'll get some game descriptions from the team that you're replaying. This one is for the Whiz Kids. I think it's one of the best ones, this particular one. The quality can be a little bit uneven, but for about $20, you get a full season description and individual biographies of all the players and coaches and broadcasters for that team in that season. So if your team that you're replaying was kind of a big deal, it's definitely worth seeing if Sabre has written a book about it. The next type of book about a season is the player's account. And this is Robin Roberts' view of the 1950 Whiz Kids. But, and some, again, not every team has them. But if your team was semi-popular in the public eye, the players on that team will write biographies. And it keeps you going because you get some firsthand accounts of what the games were like that you're doing the replay of. And so it really kind of stokes your interest. See how the players in real life compared to what you're seeing on your replay table. Very interesting stuff, especially Robin Roberts was a very articulate person. And yeah, it was ghostwritten or co-written by Paul Rogers III, who's a good writer. But so they're kind of teaming up on it. But it's a very good book. And there's books like this about lots and lots and lots of teams. Next item that I want to tell you about is one that you might not think of. And that is library books. I'm talking about retired library books. This one is for the Chicago White Sox, the Go-Go White Sox, the 1959 Chicago White Sox. Written by Jerome Holtzman, who was a beat writer for the White Sox that season, and later on was a columnist and invented at least the save concept in 1969 for Major League Baseball for relief pitchers. Hugely influential sports writer. Jerome Holtzman was a great writer. And what you find with these books is this is kind of a history of the White Sox, but it brings you up through 1959. What you find with these books is when a team does something special, that the beat writer back in the day would write a book about them. And this is the case with Jerome Holtzman with this White Sox book. It's also the case with this book about the Chicago Cubs. Yet the whole history of the Chicago Cubs, these are retired library books. If you find them in a used bookstore, they're giving them away. I mean, it's like $5. It's all they're looking for. If you go to your local library, maybe they're selling them, trying to give them away. You're not going to find maybe the whole book about your team, but you're going to find stuff in a chapter about your team that you're replaying, or maybe you'll get lucky and it's the whole book. But either way, you get a contemporary account of what the team was like, what the players were like. That keeps me going. Now I've got something in my brain that I can compare to the results I'm getting on my tabletop. And I'm not spending very much. It's cheap. Here's a book about the Whiz Kids by their writer. It's about 160, 170 pages. Harry T. Paxton was their beat writer, one of their beat writers anyway, during that 1950 season. He knows about the team. He knows about the players. He knows about the games. the writing is wonderfully time-oriented, and so you don't get, it's not written like today's stuff. There is an edge to it, I will say that. You're going to get their ideas here across, but it's just in a different style, and it's great. It's wonderful stuff, so I encourage this as well. Look for these types of books, and you're going to be glad that you did. And the last one that I have just for today, and again, of course, goes without saying, you're looking on YouTube, these are World Series teams, you're looking for the World Series videos. That keeps you going. You get a visual memory of what the players were like, what the team was like. You also get on YouTube sometimes radio broadcasts. Wonderful. The broadcasters are painting a picture for you of what the players are like, what the game was like, what the teams were like. Fantastic resource, and that, of course, is free with your internet connection. Some teams also have baseball cards written about them, special sets of baseball cards produced, and if you're lucky, on the back isn't going to be just stats, it's going to be some narrative too, where they are describing the player to you, what they did, what they're known for, what they accomplished, beyond the line of stats at the bottom of the page. So again, you're not just buying willy-nilly every Topps card you can find, and you don't maybe necessarily care so much about condition, but you've got a resource that you can look at for information about the players. Maybe you want to even take the card and put them on the back, put them in a top loader, put the card behind your game card, and you got a visual of the player as well. All of these tips kind of keep your interest going, and that's the idea. You don't want your project to bog down. You're going to get some additional sources to look at, something with pictures maybe, some video from YouTube. You got some baseball cards that'll help the project along, give you more information to compare about beyond the numbers that you get in Baseball Reference or in Retro Sheet. That will help you, or in Seam Heads, that will help you stay motivated to keep going on your project, keep your interest alive. Those are some tips from me. I'd be interested in your tips in the comments below. Don't forget to check out channel membership in the description for this video, and I hope you have good luck with your project. Thank you, and have a good day. So long, everybody.